Thanks for watching India Wants to Know, India's first panel quiz show. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel and click on the bell icon to get notified about our latest episodes.
Hello and welcome to India Wants to Know, a quiz show where we don't really care too much about the right answers and worry more about the funny and the wrong answers and related interesting stories. Joining us today are the eight most interesting people who love food and love to talk about food. We are going to be discussing interesting facts about Indian food. You could say it's food for thought. For example, did you know that Kerala was once introduced to a dish which is a Turkish dish that serves more than 100 people? It is usually served at weddings. Do you know how it was made?
Somebody brought it from Turkey.
It was brought by Arabian traders to India. But it's essentially a dish where an egg is cooked inside a chicken and the chicken is stuffed inside a goat and the goat is stuffed inside a camel.
Wait, is this the version of turducken?
Turducken.
Yeah, turducken.
Oh. Because it's a turkey in a duck and a chicken. So. Oh.
Exactly, that's why it's called.
And it's like shit, so it puts a turd in turducken.
Yes.
Throughout the quiz, I'll give points based on my mood and my likability of your answer and guess and fun fact. Which state in India has the official right to claim as the birthplace of Rasgulla? Think carefully before you answer. You might go to jail for this.
One of the states in the East India.
Which one?
Because the Rasgulla has a liquid state and a solid state. I would say it's shared between two states.
Wait, no. Is a Rasgulla different from a Rasgulla?
Okay. Let's ask the Bengali in the house.
Is there a Bengali in the house?
Well, a Rasgulla is a Rasgulla. Either you pronounce it correctly or you don't.
Ooh.
Oh, okay, but I know it's because it's in some type of ras that it's called
exactly.
A Rasgulla.
That's right.
So Rasgulla is inside a roche?
Rosh.
Rosh, okay.
Yes.
Or is it rose gulab which don't
oh, yeah, that's what that makes sense.
Well, guys, it's Ferrero Rocher.
It's made of leather shoes, it's Rosh Gulla.
Oh, no.
You have to do like a Rosh Shack test to determine the
how the gulab
goes. We'll give you 5 points for Roshak test.
Did you know that the Rasgulla, the first time the Rasgulla travelled outside Bengal, it came to Bangalore. I mean, branded Rasgulla, that is.
That KC does one.
Exactly. Oh, because it got confused. Yeah. Bangalore.
Bangalore is now, why they changed the name of the state to the name of the city to Bengaluru is that there were too many Bengalis here already.
Oh. Yeah. So KC does is the answer.
Kesi Das is the answer?
Yeah.
The state. The new state
is Sri Krishna Sweets.
Is that an Indian cover of an American band?
What? Kesi Das?
Kesi and the Sunshine
Rasgulla. Sunshine Dose. Oh, wow.
No. Can you, is there a possibility that you can OD on the Rasgullas?
You can Odia.
Odia?
Yes.
Well, there are official Rasgulla eating competitions, by the way. So there would be these, you know, neighborhood clubs which would organize these Rasgulla eating competitions. And I think the record right now stands at 300 odd.
What? Yeah. I thought that's a regular Saturday afternoon for
us. The winner of these contests gets free insulin shots for life.
Do you know anyone who got into trouble for talking about the origin of Rasgulla?
Us probably in another minute or two.
Yes, I have wasted a lot of time on WhatsApp and Facebook arguing about Rasgulla.
Have you heard of this journalist called Abhijit Iyer?
Yeah.
Was this regarding the GI tag?
It wasn't actually about the GI tag. So he made multiple jokes on the state of Orissa. And one of those jokes was about how Rasgulla is not actually an Oriya dish, but it's actually a Bengali dish. The Oriya government invited him to discuss this, and upon arrival, they arrested him, and he spent more than 30 days in jail.
That's how government works.
Is he the same guy who won the Rasgulla eating contest?
West Bengal is the answer.
West Bengal is the answer. You get minus 100
But
for offending the feelings of Bengali.
But we have a Bengali who talks about Rasgulla, and it's Rasgulla, so it looks Bengali to me.
I would say, but she already said it, so I don't know if it counts.
Which
would say Orissa.
Orissa? Yeah. You get another minus 100 for Orissa as well.
Which is not the current name, by the way.
Odisha.
Yes. I have an alternate answer. Since we're going with West Bengal and it's not West Bengal, I'm going to go with Lal Salam and I will say that it's Kerala that originated the Rasgulla.
Wow. Kerala being the state of origin of Rasgulla? No, that's a bit of a...
How offended are you right now?
I'm just going to say that I hope in this Avare Kalu Parshe, they don't spare the Gulab Jamun with the Avare Kalu. I really hope they do that to Rasgulla this time and then Karnataka can claim. Like, Rasgulla Namadu or something.
The core of it is Kannada.
Was it Aryabhata before states were invented?
Well, I will say one thing, which is that no Indian state can claim the Rasgulla if they're true, I mean, if they pay any respect to history.
Yeah.
Because Indians didn't know how to split milk.
Yes.
So the Portuguese taught the Indians to split milk.
Good?
Yes. So that is how chana or cottage cheese came to be made by Indians. And if Indians didn't learn that, there would be no Rasgulla either in Orisha or in West Bengal.
So you're saying Portugal is a state in India where we discovered?
Portugal is a state in India, we call it Goa.
Basically a foreign power came to India and learned how to split.
I always knew Cristiano Ronaldo sounded Bengali.
There you go.
Just think of it this way, if they had taught us how to split milk, there would be no food at the Ambani wedding.
Oh, yes.
So, interestingly, I'm going to give 100 points to Shreyashi and team. She stumbled upon the right answer. No Indian state has the right to claim that they are the origin state of Rasgulla.
Yeah.
No. Interestingly, West Bengal does have a GI tag for Rasgulla, but it's a particular type of Rasgulla.
Bangla Rasgulla. And Mamata Banerjee had declared a Rasgulla day, I think it was last month, November, and it was celebrated. By, you know, people created these large placards with the big picture of Rasgulla and offended even more Odias in the process.
She's absolutely right. In 2017, the GI Register Office conferred the title of Bangla Rasgulla GI tag to West Bengal and said that this does not settle the debate about which is the state of origin of Rasgulla. Oriya also has specific types of Rasgulla which are different from the ones that are made in West Bengal. Mm-hmm. They in fact went on to say that even Bikaner produces Rasgulla. This GI tag is not for the generic term, but it's only based on the specific geographic region that produces a particular type of Rasgulla. Mm-hmm. So neither West Bengal or Orissa can claim to be the rightful state of origin of Rasgulla.
Nice. But it is a rightful state.
Oh, far right.
Depends on which way you're facing.
Which is the oldest Indian curry?
I have a sambar that's about 5 days old in my fridge.
This is not a personal question, but yes, you have a 5 day old sambar.
Is it kalam curry?
What is kalam curry?
It's a curry you make with the kalam. So basically an alphabet soup.
I think it's field marshal curry, appa.
I know particularly rude curry, it's from Kerala, it's called curry meen.
Let us not encourage such jokes, please.
Just try to curry flavor.
It should be kadala curry then in Kerala. Because, nuts are the first thing that people start to, you know, fry and
work with. Oh, I thought kadala curry.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
Kadala stuffed curry. And then you go to
And usually it's served one day old anyway.
Yeah. Yeah.
He doesn't believe in cuddling. The earth is flat for him. Oh, yeah. There's nothing to go round.
No, this is a question about the oldest existing proof or evidence of a curry made in India. It's over 4,000 years old. Whoa. It was found in the state of Haryana. It had few ingredients. It had ginger, turmeric, and a particular vegetable, which is technically a fruit.
Tomato.
Tomato.
No, not tomato.
Zomato.
Cucumber. No.
Just curious, how did they discover? When you, the archaeologists, they are doing the brushing and sniffing. How do you smell? How do you discover? Like
They were literally scraping the bottom of the barrel. For the
wow, okay. I mean, how is it like the workers who are building the site, like they ate the curry and now
there is some curry. That's a nice story. The other story is that they discovered it at the bottom of a toilet, which means that whatever you've eaten today, archaeologists will discover
in that case, the curry has to be misal pav because you, I mean,
you, you cannot keep it down.
That is the end product. I mean, you can't.
Is that your personal experience?
Oh, yeah.
No, I'm from Maharashtra and I agree with him. So.
Is that true? Is that the common belief around misal pav?
Don't eat misal, it's really not nice. I'm going to get killed. I'm from Pune. Please don't kill me.
We've lost those 5 viewers that we had from Pune.
So you eat misal pav, you launch certain missiles and which leaves certain
It's
deposits.
An example, it's a missile.
No.
Why is it called a misal pav? Because it shoots down like a missile.
Exactly.
Like hits your pav.
A misal pav is what comes before a misal toe. No. Except that when you eat misal pav, nobody wants to kiss you.
Speaking of fruits and vegetables, a very basic school level question. What is the difference between fruit and a vegetable?
Usually you can't eat a vegetable raw. That's how it's kind of classified.
A fruit is basically the ovaries of the plant, which have later become fertile and then they produce seeds and all. The vegetable is more probably the root or the stem or the non-reproductive parts of the plant.
Wow, that's interesting. You seem to know a lot about biology. Maybe you should do something.
A lot of food. So that's why the tomato is a big problem. Yeah. It's technically a fruit. It is basically, it has all the seeds.
It's the ovaries.
And it's the ovaries of the fruit. But it is a vegetable thanks to the American government. So the American government decided that they have to post a certain tax on certain fruits and certain vegetables. And the tomato was classified as a fruit. But then they realized there's a huge ton of tomatoes which are being imported and exported, especially brought in from South America, and they didn't want to pay that much of tax. So they declassified it as a fruit and they made it as a vegetable. So tomatoes are vegetable according to the Supreme Court of the United States, but it's a fruit according to all biologists everywhere.
Wow. You get 100 points for telling us all of that.
Yes.
For catching us up.
Thank you.
Yeah, catching us.
The reason why I said about the raw thing is, another thing is about eggplants. Because in principle, eggplant bears similarities to tomatoes and potatoes. Because like tomato, it's a fruit, but like potato, you can't eat it. I mean, you can if you want to subject yourself to torture, but you typically wouldn't eat it raw. I mean, I would rather eat a potato raw than an eggplant raw. That's why I was kind of...
Plus,
the ovaries eggplant connection. Oh, it looks neither like an egg nor a plant. So
that's why you call it a brinjal.
Is it one of those things that no one is really sure what the difference is?
It's like nobody knows.
Like there's no such thing as a fish.
Is that true? There's no such thing.
I mean, that's like a QI thing, right? The podcast is called "There's No Such Thing as a Fish." So QI is a show that loosely based on. It's like a quiz that has these interesting questions about various things, and it gives us the answers that we think are not that obvious.
Okay.
And they have a podcast where the writing team of QI,
right,
they get together and they discuss interesting facts that they find every week. And the podcast is called No Such Thing as a Fish, from where the idea came from.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So the idea came from the fact that there is no such thing as a fish.
Take that, Mamta Bennett.
Someone should have told that to Douglas Adams. It doesn't sound so nice. So long, thanks for all the no such thing. Not a nice book.
100 points for getting the right answer. Ooh. Accidentally. It is brinjal. The oldest Indian curry is the brinjal curry. Or a Bengal curry that was found in a town called Fermana, which is part of the Harappan civilization. They found old utensils with evidence of brinjal being made 4,000 years ago, along with ginger and turmeric. So that is the oldest curry. And brinjal, you're right, is a fruit technically, because it is the fruit bearing part of the plant. Vegetable is any part of the plant which is not the ovaries or the fruit bearing part of the plant. So stems, leaves, etc. are considered vegetables. And brinjal, like tomato, is considered vegetable even though technically it's a fruit.
Ironically, that's not what emoji is really, because
brinjal
is
emoji,
used
for.
Brinjal is meat in the emoji world.
Yeah, exactly.
And it's an eggplant. So.
Yes.
Fun story of brinjal is, there is an Italian traditional dessert that actually has eggplant in it. So when a restaurant called Serafino opened in Bangalore, which is I think now closed, they actually had a melanzana di cioccolata, which is eggplant, chocolates and ricotta cheese layered with each other. It's actually pretty decent.
Who made that dessert? Rachel from Friends?
Exactly.
No, it's minced
meat pie.
Decent.
Just a little jam, some meat.
Shreyashi was talking about Bengalis and their unique habits of eating. We watched this movie called Piku, which showcased a lot of Bengalis talking about bowel movements regularly. Is it a regular Bengali phenomenon?
It is one of those Bengali things, everyday things. No conversation is complete if you haven't talked about bowel movements once. My parents, everyone in my family loved Piku because it was like they were watching a slice of their life. And you go to a doctor in Calcutta or anywhere in Bengal for that matter, and the first thing you talk about is how were your bowel movements this morning. So that is basically the barometer of your health. And they will go into the deepest details about the consistency, the color, and how much effort you have to put into the act.
Sounds like
and
cooking
everything.
Actually.
Yes.
Like, sounds like preparing food or something.
So when Bengalis go to buy furniture, do they ask for a stool stamp?
All across the nation, they trust in defecation.
So it comes from the Bengali tradition. Like they say, instead of das, they say dosh. So there's vowel movement.
Very nice, vowel movement.
You know, people say that Bengalis speak basically Hindi or any other Indian language. It's just that they round off everything. It's O. Everything is like an O.
It's like totti.
So they like their vowel movement as much as they like their vowel movement.
So if you don't like the Italian football team, it is Francesco Totti.
So they like fishes and they like feces.
Yes. Oh, no. Not a fish, not a fish.
And another little nugget I will share
nugget.
With you.
Oh, nugget!
Yes, I will share with you is that the biggest Bengali film stars have all endorsed some liver tonic or some, you know, medicinal thing that aids your bowel movement.
Oh, wow. I think Kishore Kumar has once endorsed
laxative.
Yeah, I think so.
Isap Goal, is that it?
Isap Goal, and there are these, you know, tonics called Livosin and Liva God and Liva something. And all the top Bengali stars appear in there.
Wow. So apart from football goals, they are interested in Isap Goal.
Yes, Isap Goals.
Mile churan mera tumhara.
What did the Portuguese misspell with an O at the end after hearing the name of that particular fruit in Malayalam?
I have a guess, but I'm afraid that it might be the correct answer. Yeah, so I'm same.
Are you thinking the same?
Yeah, even I am thinking.
I think we should all just go together. 1, 2, 3 and we should just go together.
Okay. Don't do that when you're shitting.
Okay, Abhijit, why don't you give us the answer?
Is it the mango?
Why?
Because it ends with an O.
And where is it originally from? Can you tell us a bit of the...
According to Jataka tales, it was a king who discovered it because monkeys were dropping them from the forest cover. But I think it was somewhere in the Western Ghats.
Interestingly,
manga is monkey, right?
Oh yeah.
In Tulu.
No, it came from the king's wife and her husband ran away with somebody else. She said, where did that man go? And that's where the fruit's name.
Also, if you add another O to mango, it becomes mango, which is like the shit and that binds the Bengalis together.
Guess what? The Bengali word for a particular kind of dysentery, where you basically...
Types.
If you make me go into graphic details, I will say that you pass bowels of mucus-like consistency in that, and it is called amasha, which is basically, which literally translates into English as mango hope, because if you eat too many mangoes, you get that kind of a dysentery.
Where is that fake news? Is that true?
It's totally true.
Mango hope. It actually means mango.
Yeah.
Aam ke aam, gutliyon ke daam.
I'm not sure if I'm ever having armrest again.
Think of that, or think of chunky peanut butter.
This is like how the Eskimos have different words for snow.
Yeah.
Yeah. You guys are expert for
different types of dysentery.
I know.
I'm going to give 50 points to Abhijit and team. You're absolutely right. It is mango. Mango, the English word, comes from the Malayalam word manga. When the Portuguese landed in Kerala, they found the exotic fruit and they wrote back to their friends and family back home. And somebody misread the A for an O. Portuguese have a habit of adding an O at the end of everything. Tomato, potato.
Alfonso,
tobacco, all of them come from Portuguese. Alfonso.
Fernando.
Yeah.
All those names. And that's how the word mango comes into the English language, from the Malayalam word manga. The word manga, interestingly, comes from?
Comics.
Japanese comics.
No, it doesn't come from the Japanese word for comic.
The Jataka Tales was a comic that I read.
Oh yeah. Did a Hindi guy ask for the word?
Manga. Oh, nice. No. Interestingly, it comes from Hindi. Manga comes from Tamil. Most Malayalam words come from Tamil. In Tamil, it used to be called Manga Kai, which comes from Hindi meaning Amphal. So Amphal became Amkai. Amkai over a period of time sort of got construed into Mangkai. And that's how you get the word mango in English language from Malayalam. So Kerala has contributed to the world with names of fruits. Bengalis have contributed to the world with different names of dysentery. Yes.
How do white people get away with like making mistakes like this and it becomes like a
cultural thing?
Yeah, because like even the Indians in the US are still called Indians and everyone's okay with that because a white guy said, yeah, they're Indian.
No, but that's kind of, I mean, not to defend them, but that's kind of how language evolves, right?
So, but it doesn't evolve around them. No,
not just around them. There are a lot of things that we have adopted from English, like police. police station comes from police. So there's a school of linguistics that is prescriptivist, which says that language should be defined by a central body or by definition, by education. And there's the descriptivist, which says your mispronunciations and your fucking it up is what makes language come alive.
So, but then the New York Kotwal department doesn't sound so nice. No, NYKD sounds nice.
Korwal. Korwal.
Fucking it up makes yes. it come alive is a very good way of putting it. Yeah.
That's life, please.
Speaking of mango coming from manga, do you know of any other food names that come from Malayalam?
There's one. Jackfruit.
Jackfruit? What Jack does fruit. It come from?
It essentially comes from Chakkapalam. That's Chakkapalam or...
Yeah. Chakka is what we remembered as in Malayalam. We used to call jackfruit as Chakka. And that's how Chakka comes
from. Or Shoaib Akhtar. Chakka.
Chakka, yeah. Oh, Shoaib Akhtar.
Don't tell that to a North Indian person.
I'm so glad you didn't say Muralidharan.
Yeah.
So in 1968, the Pakistani foreign minister, he made a visit to China. And when he was there, he gave a crate of 40 mangoes to Chairman Mao.
Oh.
And at that time, there were about 700 workers who had gone to a university in Huishang to quell a revolt. Some of them were killed, but eventually the revolt was quelled. So Chairman Mao decided, okay, do what? We'll send the entire crate over. So he sent the crate of 40 mangoes to these people. Now, Chinese people had never seen a mango before. Had never. Mango is an exotic fruit to them. And suddenly, Chairman Mao, the most important person in the country, had sent a crate of mangoes. So they decided that every big factory in the country will get one mango each. So soldiers came with one mango, gift wrapped, and gave it to the people in the factory. Now these guys didn't know what to do with them. So like, do we eat them? Do we do? Then everybody said, no, these are from Chairman Mao. These are basically from God himself. We'll preserve them. Oh. So all 40 mangoes, some were preserved in formaldehyde, some are, not were, are. Wow. Are preserved as in a wax sealing and wow. they still exist, and there are now rituals which are built where every once in a while the whole congregation of people go around the mango, they worship it and thank it and say that a piece of Chairman Mao's soul resides in these mangoes.
I have a question. If they did preserve them, do they now call the pickle Mauda's recipe?
But yeah, if you go there, if you actually just go to China and look for the golden mangoes, there are 40 mangoes which are enshrined, which are from Pakistan.
Is this a true story or
it's absolutely true story.
Pakistan or is it Pulp Fiction?
Oh! Nice.
Incidentally, yeah. Mango in Kannada is Mao. Mao.
Is that true?
Mao.
Mao.
In Marathi, Mao means soft and it also means aunt. So,
oh, soft aunt.
That's true.
Mao. Mao.
Mao.
No. The only way to round this off is Latin name Mangifera Indica. I just had to say that. Yeah.
And if your aunt takes a shit, it's called Maushi.
Oh.
Oh.
Okay. Does anyone know it's called Alfonso?
Oh yeah. This is named after the military general, right? This is a Portuguese military general who, he was a very good seafaring general. He won a lot of wars and sea. And they decided to name after him Alfonso. No, Alfonso Cuarón is a director. So it's some other Alfonso.
Albuquerque.
Yeah. Albuquerque. Yes. And that's why it's named in his honor. Yeah.
100 points to you for telling us the Mao story. 50 points to you for knowing Alfonso Albuquerque.
Yeah, oh, I have a lovely arm story. Just in case you want to see the poster of Kya Cool Hai Hum or Kya Super Cool Hai Hum or one of them, Tushar Kapoor's nipples look exactly like Tota Puri arm. So please think of that the next time you eat one.
He was smuggling raisins.
Yeah.
Isn't it I love that you did the gesture.
Yes,
smuggling. Tota Puri or Tita Puri? What?
means the same
Teach.
Thing. So, you know, a lot of Indians call breasts mangoes, right? And I've actually been catcalled with that, so fuck you to the guy who did that. There's also a footballer really named in that same vein, and his name is Alphonse Areola. So, really, he's got a beautiful name.
Oh. I don't know what it is with fruits and sexual innuendos, right? There's bananas.
Melons.
And then ovaries.
And then there's the word fruity itself.
And it's always about pairs of fruit.
No.
And not the pear.
I got Except when you're talking about a banana. If there's a pear
and two oranges.
If there's a bunch, then you're in trouble.
Oh.
Unless you have a feet fetish. It's pear.
It's called banana kake.
Okay, let's move on. What is interesting about the largest pot that you will find in the town of Manipal in Karnataka?
There is nothing interesting about the pot that you find in Manipal.
Why do you say so, Shilpa? You don't find the pot interesting?
No.
It's all been used by the bongs.
Yeah.
We're infested with bongs in Manipal. Yeah.
It's a stoner's throwaway.
Yeah.
No, this is about a particular building that spread over 2,500 acres in Manipal. that's in the shape of a particular pot.
Do they call it Manipal University because it's full of shit? Please don't kill me.
No, this is about a particular building in the town of Manipal that's in the shape of a pot that is found in that was found in the Harappan civilization. What do you think is unique about this particular building?
Wait, the Harappan civilization reached all the way to Manipal?
No. It's inspired by one of the artifacts found in the civilization. That's what I meant. Let me tell you something. It was created by a gentleman who's familiar on television and was a graduate of Manipal University.
Mohandas Pai.
Who else do you know from Manipal University or who studied in Manipal?
Was it inspired by a toilet, a potty building or something?
No, it's inspired by a pot.
So Manipal University was initially started by TMA Pai.
Right.
So is it shaped like a pot pie?
Mm.
Nice. His name is Vikas Khanna, the famous chef who travels the world and so on.
Oh yeah, I knew this.
Is that a declaration that his food is really bad?
Oh, so this pot, the
yes,
pot.
Oh. Earthen pot on earthen in pot. Which.
I mean, you can use it for anything you like.
Yes, of course.
It's an earthen pot in which cooking is done. Vikas Khanna basically founded the first food museum in India. It's a culinary museum that essentially collects all sorts of utensils used from thousands of years ago from different parts of India. And it was his way of
giving. From different parts of India.
Yeah.
From parts of India.
Was his slogan Sabka Pot, Sabka Vikas?
He hasn't talking about his political affiliation, but yes.
Yet.
So this 2,500-acre museum is in the shape of a giant pot, very similar to the pots found in the Harappan civilization. It's located in the Welcome Group Graduate School of Hotel Management. As part of the Manipal University. The museum is an attempt at preserving the history of India's rich tradition of culinary arts. The museum also boasts of objects such as the plates used by Portuguese in India, a 100-year-old ladle that was used to dole out food at temples, vessels from the Konkan, Udupi and Chettinad regions. The entire display is divided into 17 different categories, including samovars, pots, cups, saucers, serving dishes, etc. Interestingly, speaking of plates, right? The Portuguese word for plate is preto. What Indian word do you think comes from this?
The Indian word for reflection plate. Is pratibim.
A South Indian word for that's plate a or a vessel?
Thali. No.
Patre.
Patre.
Oh, wow.
Right?
Oh,
nice. So, patre or patram comes from preto. So, we'll give you 50 points for that.
Well done.
Yeah, good job.
What was Jinnah's favorite breakfast item?
Mysore pak.
thank you.
Guys, don't rub it in.
Subscribe कीजिए southbay.live